यस सर।
हाय फ्रेंड्स, गुड इवनिंग। वेलकम टू इंडियन आर्थरोस्कोपी सोसाइटी बेसिक लर्निंग कोर्स। टुडे इट्स अ कोर्स वेयर वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट एसीएल रिकंस्ट्रक्शन एंड द ग्राफ्ट ऑप्शन इज बोन पैटेलर टेंडन बोन। वी हैव डॉक्टर आरुमुगम फ्रॉम चेन्नई, ही इज गोइंग टू लीड द शो। डॉक्टर आरु इज गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट हाउ टू हार्वेस्ट अ ग्राफ्ट फॉर बीटीबी, व्हाट आर इट्स एडवांटेजेस, द स्टेप्स ऑफ हार्वेस्टिंग द ग्राफ्ट, the techniques of preparation of the graft, and how exactly to go ahead and do fixation. He also is going to talk about nitty-gritties and small tips to take care that complication doesn't happen while we are doing the PTP ACL reconstruction. It's a very, very important graft for all the ligament reconstruction surgeons. And with the trend of hamstring going in, it has started to become a lost art. We have to listen to his lecture, go into details, which he's going to talk today, and ask questions to him so that we become well versed with the BTP graft. We have Dr. Namdev and Dr. Chirag. Both are young, active arthroscopy surgeons of our country and active member of Indian Arthroscopy Society. Both have got involved many times into cadaveric workshops as faculty and national and zonal meetings as well. They are panelists on this, and along with Dr. Arumugam, today they are going to sort the mystery around the BTB ACL reconstruction. All yours, Dr. Arumugam. Let us hear your thoughts about BTB graft harvest, preparation, fixation, and the possible complications and tricks to avoid it. Yeah.
Good evening to everyone. At the outset, I'd like to congratulate Dr. Subrai and his team for his excellent initiative of online teaching, and he's got up very well. And thanks for inviting me on to talk on BTB ACL reconstruction. As Dr. Obrai mentioned, when we started about 20 years ago, the BTB was gold standard for the ACL reconstruction as a gold standard graft. So I am from Sri Ramachandra University in Chennai. And we have the Center for Sports Science, one of the state-of-the-art sports science facility in this part of the world. And we've got many laurels, and it is the first, India's first center of excellence for football medicine by Asian Federation of Football Confederation. And also recently, we have launched international standard hockey turf inaugurated by the Honorable Union Minister of Sports. So coming to BTB graft, it was a gold standard, but as per this CBD's ACL register in 2016, since 2005, the use of hamstring graft rose from 80 to 98% in 2012. As Dr. Obrai was mentioning, everybody was going through hamstring. But last 5 years, we see a resurgence of BTB graft. The decline in use of STG is quoted due to increased rate of graft failure, rupture necessitating revision. Multiple studies as per this paper. Why you should prefer BTB graft? It has got sufficient strength, we all know. And more recently, Sebold has shown the actual structure of native BTB is ribbon-like. It is not cylindrical as you do it in hamstring. So it is the only graft what we have of all the choices, which has appearance similar to the native ACL. Right? And there's excellent integration of bone plug of BTB graft within the socket. And it was confirmed by a CT scan in 80% of the patient as early as within 2 months. That's why the BTB graft always thought is a gold standard. And if you really see the graft biomechanics as published in this reputed journal, if you see the BTB graft, quadruple STG, which is most popular, quadriceps, native ACL, the tensile load matches the natural native ACL. Biological incorporation is as early as 6 weeks, bone because of bone to bone, whereas quadruple hamstring takes minimum 8 to 12 weeks. The stiffness all good, but other important factor which we normally don't talk about it as a surgeons taking care of the athletes. Outcome in terms of return to sports. If you take this point, that's where the BTB graph scores over others. As early as 4 months, you can get the patient who underwent a BTB graft back to sports. Whereas the STG is early as 6 months, and quadriceps, you have limited data. Then this is the paper published in 2015, meta-analysis of all the literature review on comparison of most popular graft, BTB versus hamstring. Various point, strong graft, the BTB is better than the hamstring. And the graft quality, BTB very rarely poor graft quality, whereas the hamstring, especially our Indian population, very often you get only 7 millimeter of graft, especially for non-athletic populations. And graft fixation, since it's a bone-to-bone best fixation, cost, for the same reason, the implant cost is very less. Use an interference screw, metallic interference screw, titanium is least expensive. Graft healing is best. Stability is more stable than the hamstring in many studies. Stretch not reported at all in the BTB graft. Tunnel widening is more with the hamstring because of windshield wiper effect. Re-rupture failure is more with the hamstring. Ease of revision is also easier with the BTB. So with all these points, BTB scores over the hamstring. Then why did BTB become unpopular? Three reasons. One is anterior knee pain, donor side morbidity. Then nearly 1 decade ago, double bundle ACL deconstruction became very popular. And the double bundle ACL deconstruction is not possible with the BTB graft, obviously. Then, because of the double bundle ACL deconstruction, we are more inclined to the transportal reconstructions. So the traditional trans tibial was quoted as non-anatomical, doesn't result in anatomical tunnels. These are the main three reasons why BTB become unpopular. So we'll take one by one and see where we stand now. How the old BTB graft were harvested? Typically midline incision this long. If you have this kind of scar in front of your knee, it is not a rocket science to understand. This is going to obviously cause a lot of anterior knee pain. But what we do now here is a new BTB graft optimized. All you need is small oblique incision and create a mobile window over the knee joint so that the scar is very minimal and which will result in less anterior knee pain. The BTB harvest is art, as Dr. O'Brien mentioned, and it has got very specific steps, and I'll go over this PDF, then give the video. We start with a small cable incision, starting midpoint between the lower part of patella, upper part of the tibial tuberosity, and go over the medial side so that the same incision you can put the tibial tunnel. Once you incision is on the oblique, when other dissection or midline, and then you create the mobile window. Most important thing, you start this dissection with the knee in 30 degree of flexion, never in 90 degree of flexion. If the 30 degree of flexion, you do this, then clear the peritoneum and you save the peritoneum. This has to be switched back. And now you concentrate more on the tibial tuberosity. Once the mobile window is created, you first make the incision on the graft on tension. 90 degree of tension and middle 1/3 or 10 millimeter in width. Then you use the tibial plug, pre-drill the graft to holes so that the graft can be pulled through. Don't try to put the drill after you harvest the graft. That may lead to the break in the bone plug. Once you do that, always use the power instrument, small saw, 5 millimeter saw blade, not a bigger one. And the angle of the saw blade is important, never 90 degree. And you harvest the tibial plug and you harvest with a tongue. This is very important tongue. I will tell you in subsequent slides why it is important. Once you do that, after harvesting the tibial plug, then make the knee in a full extension. The mobile window is placed over the patella. Now again, patella pre-drilled and also the soft tissue is retracted. then you harvest the bone plug from the patella. These are the each step. And this is a video showing the same steps. As you know, notice the knee is about 30 degree of reflection. Use a skin hook to start with. Then every incision is on straight. This is a peritoneum. You must carefully lift it and incise, and this has to be sutured back. Same, you clear it over the tibial plateau. You can see easily the mobile window can move up and down. This is important. Okay. Once you do that, to make the incision on the patellar tendon, it must be in the tension, almost 110 degree of flexion. Okay. So once you make this incision, the knee is extended again to 30 degree. Now you concentrate more on the tibial bone plug. You make the outer marking. Then, as I mentioned, pre-drills. Then use this motorized saw. Never used just an osteotome and bang it. And then you go deep so that you can get the tibial tongue. And the osteotome is only to deliver the bone plug. Never use any force. When the tibial bone plug is harvested, now the mobile window is placed over the patella by making the knee in full extension. Again, pre-drill on the patella. First, take the apex of the patella so that the bone plug equal on both sides. And then you deliver the bone plug and preserve the fat pad. And this is all the incision you need. And this is the graph with the bone plug that reduces the effective tendon length, which I'll talk to you in subsequent slides. And other important
Aru, I think there is a question here. So Tejas, you can ask the question. You wanted to ask something.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, Tejas.
Sir, I want to ask you what are the diameters of the tibial and patellar bone plug? Yeah. It is the same in all patients or different according to the patient's height and
good question. I standardize. My tibial bone plug is 11 millimeter in width. Okay. And the tibial length bone plug, if you take with the tibial tongue, is almost like a 30 millimeter. So 11 millimeter of bone plug and for the tibia, and the patella, it's 10 millimeter. I'll tell you why. With 11 millimeter of bone plug and tibia, I'm able to rotate my tibial zig to get the good point anatomically on the femoral footprint transtibially, which I'll show you during my presentation. It's 10 millimeter. The length of the bone plug from the patella is 25 millimeter.
Sir, okay. Shall I ask you one question?
Yeah, please.
Sir, what do you do any like preoperative workup like before like going for the BTB harvest like X-rays to rule out the
very good question. I'm going to this. I'll come in next slide. That why we need to do that is a very important question. Other major pitfall is the graft tunnel length mismatch. Okay, so there is one standard textbook calculation is the N plus 7 degree. Okay. N is the length of tendinous portion. This is on the bone plug for the patella, the femur, and the tibia. This is a tendinous portion. So the typically the angle they say N plus 7 degree. The angle of the tibial jig should be, if they say like for it's about 45 millimeter, you must 52. But sometimes it's not always bail you out. You know, if you depend upon only this, you may end up in a problem because the tendinous portion on the each patient is different. We have done the morphometric study of the patellar tendon, which I'll be sharing you at the end of the talk. But all the patients, we go through templating of the patellar tendon. The MRI, you can study the patella length, width, and thickness, and then incisor septal ratio. Then you can see whether patella bhaga or patella alta. So if it's the patella alta, they are going to have a long tendinous portion. Then you'll be prepared for that. That's why the tibial tongue becomes very important. Then this is the overall graft length. If you see, this is the patella.
Yes.
This is the tibial tuberosity. This is a tendinous portion. Okay. But the effective tendon length is what we must be important. See, this is the effective tendon length is going to be intra-articularly. If you take entire tendon up to here and then the bone plug, and if you don't take this is a tibial tongue. right? So the patellar tendon does not insert right here. It insert into the tibial tuberosity. So if you don't harvest the tibial tongue, then you may end up with a very long tendon, which may come out of the your tibial tunnel, as you can see here, right? So this is a typical, you made a tibial tunnel. The traditional way of harvesting the bone plug on the tibia, like this. Yes. Then you see entire bone plug may hang out in case you have a longer tendon length. If you harvest the tibial bone plug with the tongue of the tibia, then entire tibial tunnel is filled with the bone. Then you don't have to have this problem of the bone plug coming out, and not necessarily have to measure the N plus 7 is not always foolproof, but that's the one point, N plus 7 to make the angle. But the tibial tongue is what we're going to 100% make sure that you will not have this problem. And to assess this, you must see the MRI and see, to harvest the tibial tongue, you have to go deeper when you go after the tibial tuberosity. All right.
So whenever, sir, the length of the effective patellar tendon is shorter, then you harvest the tongue of the this part, tibial tuberosity. Okay.
Come again. What is the question?
So if the effective length of the patellar tendon is shorter, then you don't harvest graft with the tongue.
But that is very rarely. That becomes patella baga. And patella baga, probably you won't do a BTB. That's the chance of patellar tuberosity is more.
Yeah,
ideal case, you know. So, the effective tendon length only when there is a patella baga, where you should not do the BTB.
Okay. So, one contraindication is probably patella baga. Other is, you said, some cartilage damage in the patella is also a contraindication.
That's also questionable, Dr. O'Brien, because if your patient is only 20-25, I'm an athlete, definitely going to have a condyle damage, if so, grade 1 or 2. There is no study to say that early condyle damage, cartilage damage is going to have anti-knee pain. So okay. I don't necessarily, if it is grade 4, yes, definitely. If it is only grade 2, not necessarily that I will not stand away from the BTP graft.
Okay. Tejas, you had a question?
Yes.
Can I ask?
Yes. One, in the second figure, you harvest the dead bone plug to avoid the graft tendon mismatch. So the remaining bone is out of the tunnel. So you cut it out.
Yes. You can cut it out and then you can put it on the defect.
So it is, can we not to harvest that much bone and calculate only that bone plug and only around 5 to 10 mm bone plug only. So we cannot waste that much bone, or it is not possible.
You can try it. I mean, nothing wrong. I mean, harvesting this bone is not going to cause any problem, and you can put it back into the tibial because the tendon is getting inserted here. See, the tendon is not getting inserted to the tibial tongue.
Okay. Yes.
If you make it too short here,
okay.
The tendon
you may be very close to tendon.
Yeah.
Chirag, you wanted to say something?
There are two questions.
Unmute, Chirag. Yeah.
So there are two questions. One, in smaller patients whose patellar tendon width is less than 3 cm, do you consider taking the smaller graft and bone plugs? Narrower, I mean. And the second question is, while using your jig with smaller mobile window, are there any chances that you reflect your tibial jig upwards and make a shorter tunnel? So how do you manage it?
Yeah. So with a 33 centimeter of width, I will not decrease the width of my graft. I still go for 10 millimeter. No problem in that. And with a mobile window, even though it's if you have good soft tissue retraction, you can retract. You need not decrease your angle.
What is the angle of knee while you are drilling the tibial tunnel?
90.
Rameshwar, you had a question. You can unmute and ask question. I think Rameshwar has put it on the chat box. He says that how can you avoid bone plug overhanging?
Bone plug
overhanging. I think he just wants to talk about this extra bone, which is you are ultimately going to cut it out.
Yeah, I mean,
so how it can be avoided? That's probably his question.
That is not the problem. Only the bone plug hanging out without like this. Mm. That is a problem.
Yeah.
This one is not a problem. In fact, this I sometimes they use it to fill the defect.
Yeah.
And also on the patella. But I have not done that, but you can do that. I mean, you can just, so actually, it is to your advantage.
Yeah. Yeah, Tejas.
So, sir, that extra bone you take to prevent the bone plug mismatch is up to the cartilage, to the articular margin, or below the 5 or 10 mm the articular margin?
It depends on the tibial tunnel. Sometimes when I finish, sometimes entire I can see the tibial bone plug tip right here.
Mm-hmm. No, sir. For harvesting, while harvesting.
Harvesting, what the question?
Sir, he is asking, let me explain. He is asking, while you harvest the tibial bone plug, does it, the tongue, does it reach to the tibial articular cartilage? He is asking like that.
Yeah.
So I think the tongue usually we harvest if it is 10 mm deep, it doesn't include the tibial articular cartilage, is it?
No, it won't go to the articular cartilage. See, I'll go back to this one. If you see this MR, you'll understand here. See, this is the articular cartilage here. Can you see? Right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
I'll go up to this point. This is the effective lower pole of the patella and about 5 millimeter inferior to the proximal tibial plateau. So when you go here, so your tibial bone plug will come, the tibia tuberosity. So if you just go here and bone plug our tongue, then tendon is not attached. So you have to have a good base where the tendon is attached. This amount of bone you take, you don't need not go up to here. This is where articular cartilage.
Okay, okay. That's what I'm asking. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's your MRI is pretty clear about that.
Yeah.
Good. There. Thank you, Aru, for answering all these questions. Let's go.
And other important pitfalls when you harvest the graft are, this is how ideal bone plug and the graft should be. The two bone plug on the patellar tendon, if you see the orientation of the fibers, end to end. If you're not careful, the fibers, tendon fibers will be end to end intact, but all of them not attaching into the bone plug. Right? Whereas here, entire the tendon is attached onto the bone plug, but they are not going in. This will be avoided when you're making a cut on the tendon, should be on full tension. That's why initially it starts to third year of knee flexion. Then when you're making that the incision on the tendon, I make it 110 degree of flexion. Then you won't have this problem.
So Aru, suppose we have the problem like the last picture. So would you still continue with this kind of graft, or would you probably abandon and change the graft pattern? Yeah. If the mistake happens by a beginner.
Beginner, you know, still you can kind of, still the graft is there and you can still go away with that, but you should avoid it. It's not an ideal graft.
Okay.
It's okay, but you have to go through slow on your rehab. You don't go through your standard rehab. Go slow. If you have like this, yes.
Okay.
You'll be aware of that.
Yeah.
So other pitfalls are, if you're not careful, that the bone plug can break. So what do? You can make some sutures through and through and make it, piggyback it, or remove the bone plug, then make it just as a tendon, and like a hamstring tendon can use it. Or sometime you reverse the whatever bone plug onto the tendon and make a graft. So, but again, this is all not the problem with the graft, the problem with the harvesting technique. And as I said, putting the drill hole, the most commonly this happens after the harvesting, you put the drill hole, then if you don't hold it properly, you may injure the bone plug that can have a fracture. So this all can avoid it. If you follow the steps which I described, then you can avoid all this graft harvest pitfalls.
Okay. There's one more question.
Yeah.
How do you mark the bone harvest site? Do you mark it with marker pen, or you just put knife, or you mark it with cautery pencil, or what do you do? You first incise the tendon, right, before harvesting, and then how do you mark the width and length on the tibial and patellar bone plug site?
So do you use a marking pen or something?
I started with a marking pen, and there are some template for the using art there, but now I don't use it. And just use my scalpel to mark the tibial bone plaque and the patella bone plaque.
Okay. But I think beginners should mark it better.
Mark it. And also there are some templates to have correct size on that. But with the experience, you know how big the 10 and 25 millimeters. So after I don't use it. But initially, for the beginner, use a marker pen to mark your bone plaque size as well as tendon.
So what is the average ligament size here?
What
is the average tendon length? Leave the bone pieces. What is the average which you get usually?
Okay. Normally what happens is about entire tendon graft, about 100 millimeter normally.
Oh, okay.
100 millimeter. So of which 25 millimeter goes into the femur.
Femur, yes.
Okay. Then 25 millimeter is about your intra-articular.
ACL.
Yes, yeah. Then about 50 will be the tibial tunnel.
Yeah.
Okay. So of which, if I have the bone plug, maybe
the tongue.
Tongue about almost 40 millimeter of bone, only 10 millimeter there approximately will be tendon.
Okay. That's good.
Okay. Then. Double bundle ACL reconstruction, it was thought biomechanically superior, especially rotator stability with the double bundle, but no significant difference in the clinical outcome, various studies have shown. Then another one important study with the Scandinavian registry showed high revision rate. Mainly the PL bundle was seemed to be reason for the failure. So now the consensus is the center-to-center ACL reconstruction, a single bundle reconstruction with the center-to-center tunnels at the center of the footprint restore stability as good as a double bundle. So not necessary you must do a double bundle, right? So you can do a single bundle reconstruction of the BTB. It will be as good as double bundle if you do it properly. So the reason why people moved away was the conventional transtibial thought to be non-satisfactory. You know, the conventional transtibial technique, if you remember when we started, it was based on the clock position. We aimed 1 o'clock or 11 o'clock for the femoral tunnel position when you do transtibially, but we all know the clock position no more should be followed. We talk about high or low on the femur. So conventional transtibial technique can be optimized to get anatomical location, which I'm going to talk about next few slides. So how do we optimize the transtibial technique? First, you must optimize the graft, that's important. Then the femoral tunnel position should be marked, then the tibial tunnel entry. The transtibial is more like a marriage. Once you make a tibial tunnel, nothing much you can do to get the change of femoral tunnel position. So in this technique, we're going to mark the femoral tunnel. That's the femoral tunnel where I'm going to get it. And by adjusting the tibial tunnel, I tell you and I'll show you how we can be done. The first is the graph. We saw in detail how to do that. Just to recap the question also, what is the width and length? The patella bone plug is tapered so that passing will be easier. So 25 millimeter is the length, typically 10 millimeters width. And tibia also 25 millimeter width. And the length, the 11 millimeter is the width. And with the tongue, it becomes longer. Why 11 millimeter? I tell you how to, that makes me more room to rotate the my SG. And how to negate the tibial tunnel tendon mismatch? We have to see preoperatively MRI, then the tongue, then you can avoid this mismatch. So femoral tunnel optimization, first the femoral tunnel is placed on the equidistant on the lateral femoral condyle as described by Stephen Howard. Okay. So this is the 12 o'clock position, and this is the 8 o'clock position, means the lateral wall. So you take the entire lateral wall and middle surface 50% equidistance. This is where I mark my femoral tunnel position. Then the tibial tunnel entry is a midway between the tibial tuberosity and the medial tibial border as described by Chabra. So if you remember when we started earlier, we won for femoral tunnel, we followed the clock position. The tibial tunnel entry point was close to tibial tuberosity. So actual, if you know clearly, you can see here, the tibial tunnel entry is almost closer to the MCL. This gives a good trajectory to get the anatomical femoral tunnel. So this is the video of arthroscopic picture, and you can see this is the entire middle surface of the lateral wall of the femoral condyle. And this is my position where I mark with the microfracture, right? So that is the position I want on the femur, my tunnel position. Okay. Now with the transtibially, I'll try to reach that, right? So I use the transtibial angle and the elbow hammer, the guide pin coming over. Then I use serial 8 millimeter to 11 millimeter since my the tunnel is 11 millimeter. Once I do that, then I bring in my jig, the 7 millimeter offset jig. So that gives me 2 millimeter thin posterior wall and 10 millimeter femoral tunnel, and this is the mark I made through the medial portal to the through the microfracture. So that's what the femoral tunnel, which I thought is a good position. I should get it through this transtibially. If I'm not, then I will not go through that. I'll change it to the medial portal. Okay. Now I use, sorry, go back. So lateral 50%. So this my position is marked. Now again, the tibial tunnel is, as I shown you, sequential reaming. So whatever graph you can, okay. So now you can see here, this is the point what we made before through medial portal. I'm able to reach it. Why I made 11 millimeter, the jig gives a room for me to rotate it. If I face this jig superiorly, it goes into 12 o'clock. So I will rotate inferiorly and downwards so that it gets to this point. Okay. As you can see, I rotate my jig and I get that point. So the beat pin is now drilled from tibia, then the this is the rigid reamers, we use 10 millimeter. And one point you have to be careful when you use a rigid reamer coming from tibial tunnel above, you may sometime you can damage the posterior wall of the tibial tunnel. So off late we change into the flexible reamer. I'll show you next my video. So you go up to 25 millimeter on the femoral tunnel. So this is at the end, you can see thin posterior wall, very important for the PTB, the intertranscrural fixation. Okay. Okay. So you can pray up, you can check the position, and this is a view through the medial portal. Now you can see how nicely entire femoral footprint, we have the femoral tunnel, and if you go too low, it's where the PL bundle not good. So it's more of AM bundle and some portion of PL bundle. So it's kind of equal to the double bundle. So now we create the tunnel. Now passing the graft, when you pass the graft from the, before passing it, you have to make sure tibial tunnel entry, you must clear it very well. All the soft tissues and with the saline, it can buckle up. And especially with the bone plug, may be difficult to pass through. So many times I see youngsters struggling with that. Take time in clearing the tibial tunnel entry point and the cancellous bone or the bone plug anteriorly. And also when you place the hole on the patella, the hole should not be close to the edge, then it may cut through, and is too much close to the tendon also not good. So in mid portion of the bone plug, that makes it easier to pull the graft. Okay. And also you can see, I mark the bone plug and the tendon mark with the marker. This must be at the end of the tunnel entry. Okay. If you go too much in also, okay, because more of tendon is there at the entry. But the bone plug sits out, that's good. That's not good. You may have an end of the fracture of the graft. So to know that well, I marked that. And other one point is, you create the tunnel notch here. This must be created before passing the graft. This is where the guide wire is placed. This guide wire for femoral fixation is placed through a separate portal, close to middle portal, little lower, so that the axis of the screw is parallel to the bone plug. And also I will flex the knee of almost 120 degree at this point when passing the, and passing the screw and forward it. Okay. Yeah. So I use interference screw. You can use Indian made interference screw, very cheap. And once you fix that, same way you can fix on the tibial side for outside in. As showed you, my tongue is almost at the flesh with the articular cartilage. So this is the end of the fixation. And this, how the graft looks, looking from the medial portal, the orientation without any impinging on the PCL or on the lateral wall, right? And the size of the screw on the femur, when I use the metal interference screw, about 2 millimeter less than the size of the tunnel. If it's 10 millimeter, I use 8 millimeter. Also, sometimes you can use the bio screw. When I use the bio screw, you must pre-tap it. Otherwise, the bio screw may break.
I think Tirath has a question. Tirath, yes.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. I want to know that whether putting a guide wire and doing a notch will be before graft passage or after graft passage?
No, before graft passage. After creating the tunnel, before passing the graft, you create the notch.
Okay.
Because I edited the video because of short time.
Yeah, that's okay.
And never use the K-wire anything. You cannot be economical on that. Get a good flexible wire, guide wire.
And okay, not the K-wire.
Because when you're going to hyperflex to 120, if you use just a standard K-wire, then you can pull the wire out.
Yeah. I have one question.
Tejas has a question, and then Namdev. Tejas.
The size of the femoral down or 10
times. So I'm not able to hear. Can you louder, please?
Size of the femoral screw, like tibial screw, you take it 2 mm lower than the graft
femoral
size.
Femoral is there 2 less. Femoral, okay. 2 less.
Yeah.
Femoral 2 less.
And the length is 25 millimeter.
Okay. And tibia? Tibia is also 2 mm less.
Yeah, 2 mm. Or sometimes depends on the quality of the bone. You have to 2 or 1 size less. Because the tibia may be a little softer, unlike the femur.
Yeah, Dr. Namdev, sir, please.
Sir, like I have one question regarding the remnant preservation. Hmm. As we know that in hamstring graft, it is very easy to preserve the ACL remnant. Like most of the time, it is AM bundle. But here, I think most of the time, we have to remove all the grafts like to make the perfect tunnels. Okay. Yeah. So how does it affect the graft vascularity and the joint proprioception?
Yeah, I'm not a great fan of the remnant preservation. If it is there, you do it. Otherwise, for example, if it is only a PL bundle is gone or AM bundle is gone, then probably you do just a single bundle reconstruction with the hamstring. Okay. But this kind of case, when the patient comes to almost 1 or 2 years later, when there's nothing much is left, as you can see on the femoral or also no remnant. So if it is there, you try and preserve it. But I don't do anything extra to do that. And what is most important for a successful outcome is your tunnel placement and your fixation, not the remnant preservation. And also, I see many of the youngsters trying to be overboard on the remnant preservation. They have a cyclops lesion. No, sometimes you tend to leave the remnant here. And by the end of it, it may be impinging on can lead to cyclops. You have to be careful on that.
Yes.
two, three questions here. One question is on the chat box. When you harvest the patellar tendon, does sometimes the leakage of intra-articular fluid happens if the defect is, while harvesting, there is a defect? And if it happens, do you close it or how do you manage that?
Yeah, these are the, again, the when you don't preserve the fat pad, you know. If you remove the fat pad and then if you damage, then a lot of leakage will be there. Then you can go ahead and close the dent there. Otherwise, I do it at the end of the procedure.
Okay. Okay. Another question here is, why you always want to do a trans-tibial? When you're going to put a screw from the anterior medial portal, so why don't you do a femoral tunnel from anterior medial? Because that way the screw would be parallel to your...
Yeah, good question. See, I do trans-tibial when I do a BTP graft. When I do a hamstring, I do middle portal, through the portal. Because if you do a, want to do a BTP graft through medial portal, the bone plug can't be about 25 millimeter. It should be less than 20, even sometime 18 or 19. Because when you are passing the graft, you can drill the femoral tunnel through medial portal. But when you're passing the graft, it has to come from tibia below to the femoral tunnel.
Yeah.
The plug has to flip. Yeah. If you remember, if it's 25 millimeter, then the intra-articular length is 25 millimeter. So you won't be able to flip it. So you have to compromise and your the bone plug on the femur should be less than 20. I feel why you should compromise if you can get anatomical position on the trans-tibial.
Okay. Another question here is, do you sometimes damage the MCL while you're going more medially? Is there a possibility of young person damaging the MCL if it goes more medially?
No, if you go midway between the tibial tuberosity and medial border of tibial border, you won't damage MCL. You can always do it, check it intra-articularly. You know.
Okay. Just a last question before we go to Tirath again. There are some people who would actually reverse the graft. So the what you are doing is the patellar side goes to the femur, the tibial side remains on the tibia. There are some surgeons who actually reverse the graft where the tibial side goes onto the femur and the patellar side comes onto the tibia.
That's an individual preference, but in my case, I will not do that because I am harvesting with the tibial tongue. That is my main point to get the tibial tunnel mismatch. So I have not reversed it.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, Tirath, you have the question and then we...
Sir, I want to know how to prevent graft rotation while doing screwing.
Yeah, that's why the size of the graft is 10. Your tunnel is 10. Okay. Then the graft may rotate. If you don't, that's why tunnel notch is important. Once you put the tunnel notch and the guide wire there, then the screw will, the graft will not rotate.
Sir, do you recommend the use of that reverse thread screws for the left side?
What is that?
That there are threads which are reverse threads. So for the right, you use the left thread and for the left, you use the right threads.
Otherwise, to prevent rotation.
There are some companies coming up with these reverse.
I never use them and I don't think necessary. If you take these precautions, you won't have any problem with that. Only thing is, whatever you do, don't you have to have kind of screw. It should be the screw what you use for BTB is different than the interference screw what you use for hamstring. It'll be more sharper.
Arul, Dr. Rameshwar has a question. What are the precautions which you take while you are pulling the graft up? So would you pull and you would push the graft as well somehow so that the threads don't break as you are pulling or the cut through does not happen? So I've seen some surgeons who are pulling the graft and with the probe, they're pushing the bone plug as well slightly or maybe tapping it a bit.
Sometimes
is it a combination of push and pull?
It actually goes more for the well with your graft preparation, I guess. So you have to prepare your patella bone plug more tapered at the end, and so that it goes easily. And most important thing is the tibial tunnel entry clearance. So you may think all soft tissues, because it's not so important with the soft tissue graft. The bone plug, you have to clear the tibial tunnel nicely, then only the bone plug will go easy. And sometimes you may have to use the probe, never used to bang it. What happens, you may have to kind of rotate it and guide it so that the cancerous portion remains anteriorly, but never have to use kind of bang it or use the switching stick and
to push it. So the graft towards the femoral side, you said you have to just taper it in a bullet shape so that it just goes.
Easily goes.
I think that is a point Dr. Namdev also made it. Thank you. Okay, let's proceed.
So this is now when you use a flexible reamer. Okay, same, you mark the femoral tunnel and through the tibial tunnel. And so now what happens that the guide where I'm changing it. Sometimes after reaching the tibial tunnel, you bring the rigid reamer. It may take off a little bit of the posterior wall of the tibial tunnel. So to avoid this off-rate, we're using the flexible reamer. But you have to use the different guideway for this. And with flexible reamer, I don't have any problem of any inadvertently damaging the posterior wall of the tibial tunnel, and this is the femoral tunnel, right? And as I mentioned, this is what how you look at the 3D reconstructions. You can see the tibial tunnel exactly and the center and the footprint, same on the femoral tunnel also. So as I mentioned, this is the loop-in-loop technique. So this is where I created the tibial tunnel, okay? Then I try to reach the femoral tunnel. I'm not happy with the position, so I need not compromise my femoral tunnel. Then I go ahead and do the femoral tunnel through the medial portal, right? So this is the guide wire, this is the loop through the medial portal. But passing the graft, it has to come from the tibial tunnel. That's where the problem is, because it has to flip. As I mentioned to you, IPS, then the bone plug should not be like that. So to overcome that, we use a loop and loop technique. So now another bead pin is placed from the tibia below. This is again showing your femoral tunnel. So going through this loop, the existing loop, and I'm passing the bead pin now. So this is a loop and loop. Now the graft is pulled from the tibia below. Once come here, I won't use the pull here, and I use this wire to pull it so that the graft goes into the femoral tunnel easily. So this is what called loop and loop technique, and you use the medial portal technique for reaming the femoral tunnel for the BTP graft.
Excellent, that's okay. Wonderful.
So just to read some review of literature, so this is the meta-analysis of 22 studies, about 1,000 patients almost in equal group, only level 1 and level 2. The outcomes favored the BTB in terms of pivotship and also the return to sports. So the ACLR reconstruction of the bone pattern is superior in resuming rotational stability of knee joint, allowing patient to return to a higher level of activity. This is published about 5 years ago. Then we talked more about anti-knee pain. Whenever I talk about the BTB, the one question I keep getting is anti-knee pain. So there are ways to avoid that. You know, our technique is small medial oblique incision. Then if you make a midline incision like this, you're going to have a anti-knee pain. So these authors, they've done two incision techniques about standard incision and double incision, 20 patients in each group. They showed incision which reduces the midterm incidence of anti-knee pain as well as incidence on surface of hypesthesia. This is data from our study, which we presented in ISACOS last year, about 1,200 cases, over 600 of BTB, 600 of hamstring, and our technique of mobile window technique, anti-knee pain are same as the hamstring. So the anti-knee pain is more related to the graft harvest technique than the problem of the graft itself. And what are the strategies to avoid anti-knee pain? Over the time, various group of authors have given various strategy. One is several researchers have pointed out minimizing the bone and soft tissue trauma. As Dr. O'Brien mentioned, harvesting the BTB graft is an art. So you have to learn it. Preservation of fat pad, very careful for the soft tissue dissection, and meticulous conversion of the peritoneum and filling the bone defect with residual bone chips. And these authors have mentioned double incision. Two transverse skin incision to avoid the anti-knee pain. And These authors have recently showed we can use growth factors and PRP at donors at harvest. And the Shelbourne showed a very important focused rehab and early attention to the extension. There's another important point I want to make sure. See, you can, when you make the tunnel correctly, you'll get this flexion, no problem at all. Okay, the extension is what you should concentrate. Even a 5 degree of flexion defeat to start with will have a problem. It leads to further wasting, leads to anti-knee pain. So I won't initially more bother about knee flexion. For the full extension is what I need to get it initially. Okay. In our study, we use curvilinear incision, mobilinear technique, and this extension to start concentrating on the full extension, you reduce the anti-knee pain. The other study, we have, this was a medal paper contestant for IAS and Calicut, where we assess the morphometric study of patellar tendon of 100 MRIs to see the predictability of a BTP graft as a suitable graft option for ACL deconstruction. These are the various measurements we took. As I mentioned, patella width, thickness, and the insertion ratio, the insertional tendon width and thickness. We already talked about how to harvest the tongue. This is what we found. What is published in the study, the patellar tendon length is short. It is shorter in our population already. And more importantly, tendon thickness is much more in our group. So probably it is a better quality graft for our Indian population. The MRI is a valuable tool to measure morphometry of patellar tendon and graft choice, and you have to use as a pre-templating pre-op to see the exact the diameters and the length of the tendon. Okay. So in conclusion, BTP is gaining back its original position as a gold standard. Donor side morbidity can be avoided with a careful surgical technique. And the beware of complications, give importance to every step. And conventional transceiver technique can be optimized to achieve anatomic tunnels. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you, thank you. Aru, if you can unshare your screen so we can have questions. Chirag has some questions. So Chirag, yeah. Chirag, unmute yourself and then Namdev, yeah.
Chirag. So in soft tissue graft like hamstring, it is considered that 20 mm length inside the femoral tunnel is sufficient. So why do you want to put extra like 25 mm length of the bone plug into femoral tunnel and making flipping difficult? So 20 mm length of bone plug in femoral tunnel isn't enough? What do you say?
Well, I think the hamstring, many compromises are made. If you can 20 millimeter, how do you know it's effective? Mm-hmm. And that's why more and more research have come out now. That's okay for a normal patient, not for high-end athlete. If you're a high-demanding athlete, you want to ask them, want to go earlier, I don't think you'll be happy with 20 millimeter of just a tendon inside the your tunnel. No.
So why? And also, the smaller you have that plug, the chance of breakage is also more.
Yeah. So our original BTP graft of 25 millimeter, and if you can try and achieve that in the transtibial, why do you want to compromise?
Absolutely. I think that's point well taken.
There are other two questions. Can I ask?
Right yeah, now? Yeah, sure. Please, Chirag. Yeah.
So there is other questions. It is said it is better to keep the cancellous part of the bone plug in contact with the femoral tunnel and put your screw beneath the cortical part. So do you always follow it, or if yes, then how to place your tricho graph?
Now, as I showed you, the cancellous bone is facing superiorly. My screw goes between the cancellous bone and the tunnel. That is important. Why? If you see the tendon is attached on the cortical bone. So you're going to put a screw on the cortical bone, you're going to damage the tendon. So I would not do that.
I think that's a very, very good point.
Yeah, so do you manage to rotate it, or it is always goes like this, or sometimes you have to take it out and you have to rotate the graft and put it back. So how do you always manage it?
If you properly make your graft preparation and the tunnels properly, I don't find any difficulty in passing the graft.
Okay. And
it is not a forgiving graft. Unlike the hamstring,
You have to spend time. You have to spend time preparing the graft.
Every step can be stuck. So it takes more time, but you have to be careful. That's the reason why not to do away. But every step.
And do you use in the PCL also BTB or other graft?
PCL, I sometimes use the BTB. Otherwise, I use hamstring, or also now also using the Peyronie's longus.
And what are your indications for hamstring graft in ACL? Do you always use BTB or sometimes hamstring also?
Yeah, good question. Of course, skeletally immature, you can't do a BTB. And then I use a hamstring. And if you go and see the entire AM bundle is intact, only PL bundle is reconstructed, then you use the hamstring. And sometimes 40 years, 45-year-old housewife still have a difficulty in the ADLs, then I won't do a BTB, just do a hamstring. And also in a male, 45 plus 50 is not very... my indication for BTB are more younger patients.
Athletic.
And do you use extra-articular procedure any in your athletes for the ACL reconstruction, or you with the BTB you are satisfied with the BTB graft and you don't add Lemaire's or any other kind of procedure?
The extra-articular kenosis is only if you have at the end of the procedure you have a still pivot shift present, you have to do it. But when I do with the BTB, I never had a position or a situation where at the end of the BTB still have the pivot shift. So with the BTB, I never did any.
Additional
kinodesis.
Okay. Navdev, yes, Dr. Navdev. So, can we have a little bit more insights on the anterior knee pain? Because, we don't know, for how long it lasts, for 1 year, 2 years, whether it is self-limiting, like the frozen shoulder, whether it does affects the final rehabilitation of the quadriceps muscle.
The anterior knee pain is not unique to the BTB. Even with the hamstring, you get it.
Okay.
So, as I said, anterior knee pain, most important thing is you have to get the full extension. And immediate post-op, even 5 degrees of knee fixed flexion. Even more with the BTB. You need to avoid that. I would rather put a full straight leg. I won't start the knee bending immediately unless you get the full extension.
Yes.
So if you have that, you have to get a full extension. When you make the correct tunnels, I never had any problem with getting the flexion. The extension is what is a difficulty in getting it. So if you get it, then the anti-knee pain will not be there.
Okay.
But there is a question. In a patient, female patient with hyperextension in the knee, would you do BTB or would you shift to hamstring? And if BTB, what are the precautions you do?
Hyperextension, I'll do the that's one indication to do a BTB.
That's an indication to do a BTB. But you would tighten it the same way as you would do.
Same as opposite knee.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, Tejas, you had a question.
As you said, after BTB graft, if the pivoting is still left, you do extra articular procedure. So you always do in the second stage, or you check it after ACL reconstruction?
What is the question again?
So his question is, if there's a pivot shift even after doing your hamstring on table, BTB, you would then do an extra articular in the same sitting, or you would?
The same sitting. Yes, but as I mentioned, never encountered a problem of pivot shift. See, these are the extra articulars on primary ACL reconstruction rarely do. Only for revision only you need to do that. And that is more or less pre-op. Now you have a grade 3 plus pivot shift, you anticipate that. Very rarely that at the end of the procedure is still a pivot shift.
So Dr. Satvir has a question that when you are pulling the graft, if the graft breaks, maybe he wants to talk about the bone plug getting broken. Any special tips in those situations?
Yeah, the bone plug breaks, as I showed you in my graft preparation. If you can repair it, you can with some whip stitches, you can do it, or remove the entire bone plug. You make it as a soft tissue, like how you do a quadricep tendon. One side bone plug, one side soft tissue, then go ahead and fix it.
Okay. Bhupesh, you have any question?
About your experience regarding the femoral fixation, like BTB, endobutton CEL, instead of the screws?
Well, I have endobutton CL as a big backup. Sometimes you have a posterior wall is not there, then you have to as a backup as a cortic fixation, but I never used it. And I always have as a backup, but never have to use it. And with a BTB, that is the biggest advantage. All you need is a simple interference screw. You can fix all your graft. That's the best fixation of the orthopedic surgeon we know. Interference screw, a titanium interference screw.
Yeah, Bhupesh. Bhupesh, you have any question?
No, sir. No question from me.
No question. Okay, Tejas, you had a question.
As you mentioned, you use a 5mm saw and some other instrument for the BTB, but in some periphery or the non-affording patients, we cannot use all these things. So is there any other technique by using a regular saw, or it is not recommended to use a regular saw?
I can't hear. Can
you
repeat?
He says that you said that you really need a very good precision saw and a blade which is small, 5mm blade to harvest the graft. In a periphery where the saw is the big one, the man one, and a big blade, do you really want to do it, or they want to, it is a very risky thing to do?
If you have, sometimes people don't have saw, then they make multiple drill holes and do that. That's the recipe for disaster. You know,
okay.
Those kind of, you can't compromise. And I think these questions, like, you know, for example, you know, some people cannot afford arthroscopy. You can do open ACL. So I don't think you should do that. Arthroscopy is expensive, but you have to have a proper equipment, equipment and instruments. Otherwise, you're not doing any justice to the patient.
Do you recommend to prehab of the quadricep and for the extension? Post-operative better extension of the knee, if you have a chance to do the prehab.
So do you prehab these patients sometimes, Arun, before taking them for surgery?
It depends. I don't have any hard and fast rule. Sometimes I operate a cell if possible within few days or within 3 weeks. So sometimes when the patient comes after long standing, two years of ACL, a lot of cortis are wasting, obviously you have to pre-op and do it. So all depends on individual patient. It's not a standard procedure. And if there's obvious cortis are wasting, you're not going to go in and do your ACL there. You have to pre-op and rehab before going into your surgery.
One question.
Yeah, Chira.
So after what time you allow your athletes to go back to the sports, and what are the prerequisites before they are going to sports? Yeah.
Well, that is a very important topic and also quite controversial. The textbook says 9 months. There are various sports-specific exercises and criteria to get back to sports. And if you ask me personally, what is the earliest? Well, there are real-time situations where high-end athlete he has to go back to sports, otherwise you lose career. The earliest I have sent the patient is 4 months, the football player. But that's the earliest I have let them go. Because otherwise, his team is going into Super Cup. If you don't play, he loses his career and life. So that's the earliest. Otherwise, typically it's 9 months or so, and there are a set of criteria they have to do it, especially our setup, including isokinetic testing. You must have, there's no difference, not more than 10% between the operated and non-operated, and also the antagonistic and agonist ratio should be more than one. All the criteria are there.
Do you use, Aru, sometimes a bio screw or a bio HS screw instead of a titanium screw as well?
Yeah, sometimes I use bio screws, especially some patients are very kind of afraid of bone. So in that case, you need to pre-tap. After putting the guide wire, there is a pre-tap of the tunnel. You have to do it, then use the bio screw. In fact, one CT scan what I showed was a bio screw. Otherwise, the metals have a scattering image.
Okay, perfect. So I think, yes, Namde, please.
Does the very aggressive rehab and the early return to sports leads to the graft laxity? What are your thoughts?
Not with the BTB.
Yes. BTB, that's a very, very important point.
Yes. You can be a bit aggressive with BTB on rehabilitation because, yes, it does not stretch out. I think wonderful presentation, Aru, and I think we had excellent discussions. Thanks to both Chirag and Dr. Namdev for initiating discussions. We had a lot of questions coming up, which you answered well. And I think these 3-4 points, which were quite remarkable about reading an MRI before you are actually harvesting the graft, is important. And then when you harvest the graft, keeping that tongue, I think that was critical. And I think it has made our life so much easier because once you keep the tongue, then the mismatch things are avoided. And also that loop-in-loop technique, which you showed, is wonderful, especially if you want. And in sometimes you are not able to do from the medial portal and you have from the trans-tibial and you are going for medial portal. Overall, an excellent presentation with the tips which have actually made us enlightened about the BTB and made us more confident to go back in our practice and maybe try BTB in some of the high-end athletes or younger people because we are quite afraid of it and we have actually shifted from BTB over to hamstring. And I think it's time to relook at this graph and do it again. Thank you very much, entire panel. Thank you, Aru. Thank you, Sandeep, Bhupesh and Rajiv for joining in. Thank you, Tejas, as usual, Tirath, Mukesh, Rameshwar to join in, Amol as well. There are some surgeons from Kuwait, etc., who also joined in. They did not ask question, but they were face-to-face with you. Thank you, for Aru. I think it was an excellent teaching program. 1 hour well spent today with all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sandeep.
Friends, next week, we do have an coming up on 24th July. We have, do we have one before that? Is it this one or we have, Sandeep, oh. I think we have Dr. Valenti, which is a bit no, more. That's isn't it?
Yeah, Dr. Valenti is on Saturday, sir. 25th.
He's on 25th.
Yes.
Okay. So on 24th, we do have Dr. James Sladder. Yeah, Dr. James is from Imperial College, London. He's from Bioengineering Department. And this is a talk about Achilles tendinopathy. Where are we today? I think we have seen a lot of tendinopathies and what is latest happening in tendinopathy is important. Let us join on 24th July at 7 p.m. to hear from Dr. James Sladder, who is from Chelsea and Westminster Hospital in UK regarding latest what is happening in Achilles tendinopathy. Thank you, panel, for joining in. Thank you, Aru, for joining in. Excellent discussion and one.